I'm Cecile Nieuwenhout, a postdoc researcher at the University of Groningen. Over the past year, I've done a lot of research about the legal and regulatory framework for the positive plans, so for the different transition tracks and the different proposed projects inside the positive project. And one of the aspects is the sustainability of cultural heritage buildings. That's a specific aspect of the positive project. And in this presentation, I would like to show you how laws and regulations are applicable to these type of buildings and how they make sustainability in cultural heritage buildings challenging, but also what solutions there are. The three things that I would like to discuss are first a snapshot of the relevant laws and regulations, then the challenges and opportunities of these laws and regulations, so what should or could be done differently, and third, examples from practice, so how to adapt projects to local regulations. And I reshuffled the presentation a little bit so that instead of having these three things after each other, I will actually first go into the Netherlands and then into Portugal for these three things. So that's how the presentation will go. If you have questions, you can ask them in the chat or wait until the end of the entire seminar, where there will be a Q&A session. So first, a legal snapshot. I will try not to make it too theoretical, but I will just quickly go into international law and the national regulations of the two countries. So for international law, what is very important is the Granada Convention on Architectural Heritage. This convention aims to conserve cultural and architectural heritage for future generations. But I think what's a very important insight from this convention is that the value of heritage lies in it being used. If you have a beautiful castle, but no one is allowed to enter, what is the value of the heritage? Especially if it is possible to make something out of it with a societal or cultural added value, it's important to make sure that the buildings are able to be used. So. Of course, this requires changes to be made sometimes. You want to preserve the values of the building. If it's possible to use the building with not too many changes, that would be ideal. So that's also something that will come back in the rest of the presentation. So what does the convention concretely say? It says that countries should make rules about cultural heritage. First of all, of course, to protect heritage, so including supervision of this heritage. They need to provide financial support to preserve the heritage and adopt integrated conservation policies. This is, for example, that it becomes an essential part of city planning and that restoration and renovation of heritage buildings is promoted and also facilitated in the town planning process. And finally, it's also important that there is cooperation between countries and cities and that public awareness is increased for the value of heritage buildings. Of course, there's much more to say about international law, but due to the time constraints, I will not go into detail. Of course, you can check out the deliverable for all the further considerations of international and also European law. Going into the legal snapshot of Dutch law, it's actually quite complicated what Dutch heritage law says at the moment, and that's because there's a major overhaul of spatial planning and construction law due to the new Omgevingswet, which was supposed to be introduced already several years ago, but which is delayed several times and which will hopefully be introduced within the next year. In any case, the rules are that it is not possible to change the buildings, cultural heritage buildings, without permission. So, for example, new paint is fine if it's in the same color, but anything more invasive than that needs to be tested by a committee. In order to make the process go smoothly, there is a one-stop shop, the Omgevingsloket. And this authority determines who is the correct authority to test your plans. So, for example, heritage can be local heritage or state heritage. And if it's local heritage, it will probably be the municipality who was responsible, but other authorities may have to be consultant. And these other authorities are the State Service for Cultural Heritage, the Rijksdienst voor Cultureel Erfgoed. So what do you need to do if you want to make a project work out? So when you want to renovate a cultural heritage building in such a way that that the energy transition can also take place there. First of all, you need to have a thorough preparation. So early involvement of the municipality as a key authority is very important. Second of all, it should be an integral plan. So you should not only look at the sustainability, but at the entire renovation and maintenance plan. The idea is that if you do a major overhaul of the building, then you do it well, not only for the energy components, but also to make sure that it can last for another few decades. Although many people think about solar panels as the first obvious choice of renewable energy, the first focus should actually be energy saving. So isolations and making installations more energy saving. And why is that? First of all, it's less invasive to the looks of the building because it's often about what's in the walls or between the ceiling and the roof. So it's not really visible from the inside or the outside. Of course, it could be visible, but it's not so invasive as putting a lot of solar panels on the roof. And what's also not entirely unimportant, often energy saving has a higher return on investment than building solar panels, for example. So that's, of course, as cultural heritage is expensive to maintain, a return on investment is very important, especially because the heating bill is very often quite high for cultural heritage buildings. And then, of course, what we normally all think about, generation of renewable energy, putting solar panels on your roof, that comes second. So concerning the latter, there should not be high expectations about how many solar panels you can put on the roof, since the roof surface of monuments is actually only very small in comparison to the total amount of roof surface. So if you look at all the roofs in a country or in a city, it's better to start with all the other roofs than to work on the most expensive roof that you have. What's also important is that not all roofs or surface can be used because of the angle or the orientation of the roof. And often monumental buildings have many chimney pipes or different angles, which makes it actually more complicated than modern buildings. And it's often also more expensive than other buildings. So there are old roof constructions and different materials to work with, or different design, no standardized design. And of course, there's a large visual impact on the monument, which makes it difficult to get the permissions in order. So although many monument owners find sustainability important and have an intrinsic motivation to put renewable energy at the heart of their interventions, solar panels are not often used when it comes to making monuments more sustainable. So what can you do to work around these problems? For example, you can use solar slates if the roof construction itself is not a monumental value. Or you can color the solar panels in the same color as the roof. So it will not be as contrasting and it will be less invasive. Or what you can also do is not build it on the main building, but on side buildings that are built later. So, for example, if there's a castle and there's stables on the side, then you can see if maybe you can not put it on the castle, but you can put it on the stables or the garden sheds or other buildings. So here are some examples. The top left image shows a very stark contrast between the solar panels and the roof. And the right image shows how you can also integrate the solar panels inside the slates and make a very, well, smooth looking roof. What is also relevant in the left image, typical for Dutch cities, is that well, the houses are very close to each other, and this part of the roof will probably not be visible from the street, making it acceptable to put solar panels there. The lower image shows a much more invasive renovation. So here, basically, the entire building is renovated and the entire facade is changed, but in such a way that it respects the building. And that's very important, that in some way the values of the building are still, well, preserved, and that you can still do an energetic renovation even though you keep the values of the building. But this type of renovation costs a lot of preparation time that should be discussed with the municipality. Then we go to Portuguese law. First of all, I should say credits for this part go to Hugo Evangelista, who worked with us for this part of the deliverable and who also did a lot on this presentation. So first of all, Portuguese heritage law establishes that buildings classified as being of interest are in special protection zones. And although some buildings are not really protected, if you are in a protection zone, that means the buildings are classified. Well, that asks for extra permits, basically. So restrictions do apply to works on the protection zones and the classified buildings. But how exactly this works and which restrictions apply differs per building or zone. Principles to be observed when modifying buildings of interest are listed below. So prevention, planning, gradualness, inspection, and information. Going to Portuguese construction law, the installation of certain renewable energy production facilities are of limited urbanistic relevance and exempted from prior checks. So this is, for example, about solar panels. So normally you can put solar panels without any prior checks. However, that does not apply to protection zones and buildings classified under Portuguese heritage law. So they do require licenses. And these licenses have to be approved by the municipality. But following heritage law, this is only possible when the IGESPAR gives a favorable decision. So without this, no entity can provide licenses for changes within protection zones. And what's also important is that the specific requirements for constructions are established at municipal level. So this is not really a local, a state requirement, but only local requirements. So if you go to the local requirements, well, there's a whole range of things that could be local requirements, and they complement construction and heritage law, as mentioned before. So what could be said, for example, the color and the materials and style used in parts of the buildings and the roof. For example, you could require that PV panels should be hidden from public view and comply with additional positioning and coloring requirements. Or you could say, for example, that window frames should not be made of certain materials. So these are all pictures from Evora, and well, you can see that if you have local requirements about these things, it becomes quite difficult to well, to go for a complete overhaul of the building. So what are possible solutions that could apply here? First of all, again, you can use colored solar slates that comply with the style requirements. You can plan modifications that do not affect the specific elements of the value of the building. And I think what's also very important is listening to the next presentations in this webinar, because those will be given by experts in how to work around all the rules and regulations in practice in a technical sense. So this is a short introduction of all the legal and regulatory requirements. I hope it was not too theoretical for you, and I hope you enjoyed it. And if you have any questions, please put them in the chat, or you can always send me an email at ctnieuwenhout@rug.nl. Thank you very much.